start it with the hydrodynamic nonlinear shear term over here, and the net effect, which we'll be demonstrating shortly, is going to be updraft enhancements on the flanks of the initial updraft in the vertically sheared environment, and cell splitting. That is going to be what we're initially going to talk about for this nonlinear shear term over here, where we get two counter-rotating vortices on the flanks of the initial updraft that is impinging on the background horizontal vorticity associated with the vertically sheared environment. So we're going to isolate that term over there on the right-hand side of the equation to show that del squared p prime is equal to the other terms, minus rho naught times 2 partial u prime partial y partial v prime partial x plus 2 partial u prime partial z partial w prime partial x plus 2 partial v prime partial z partial w prime partial y, just rewriting that over there, plus dot, dot, dot. And there is an extra credit problem on the exam, where you will be asked, if you choose to go through with this extra credit problem, to show that this particular term can be expressed as 1/2 times a bunch of terms minus partial v prime partial x minus partial u prime partial y squared minus other terms. So you'll show that as extra credit on exam number 2. But what I want to talk about in particular is this term over here, minus partial v prime partial x minus partial u prime partial y. Remember, this over here, this term is just the perturbation vertical vorticity about a vertical axis. So again, we're dealing with zeta prime squared here on the right-hand side. That falls out immediately from manipulations to this term over here, this hydrodynamic nonlinear shear term over here, that can be expressed in terms of vertical vorticity perturbation squared, which you'll be able to show on the examination. So this particular component, which we'll talk about here, represents pure rotation, and we're going to focus on that, pure rotation about a vertical axis. And what we're going to do in this process is only focus on this, ignoring all other terms in this particular equation and how it falls out that would otherwise be associated with deformation and divergence, and we'll cover those terms when we talk about fluid extension, which is going to be related to stretching, for instance, and a little bit later on in this lecture. So we can express this particular right-hand side once we are dealing with del squared p prime. We're going to remind ourselves now dealing with nonlinear shear term is equal to a bunch of terms which we'll be dealing with on the exam, minus rho naught times 1/2 times minus partial v prime partial x minus partial u prime partial y squared plus dot dot dot. And effectively, this over here can be expressed on the right-hand side as dot, 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 plus, one, plus, minus times minus is plus, 1/2, and then we're going to just deal with over here rho naught times zeta prime squared, plus a bunch of other terms over here. And if we continue over here and just think about this physically without this constant density, because we're assuming that density is a constant over here, we can simply express the left-hand side, del squared p prime, we're taking two derivatives, thinking of sinusoidal wave patterns, take two derivatives, we just get back out minus p prime NL shear is going to be equivalent to, we're going to ignore the 1/2 rho naught just to talk about physically what's going on from a proportionality perspective, is going to be equal to, or proportional to, minus zeta prime squared. And that minus sign should actually be a plus sign over here, such that p prime NL shear is proportional to minus zeta prime squared. All right. So you might be thinking, well, what does this mean over here? This says that wherever we have vertical vorticity, whether it's positive or negative, because we're squaring it, we always get a positive value by squaring it, because this minus sign is out front, that whether we're dealing with either cyclonic or anticyclonic vertical vorticity, that is going to be associated with a pressure deficit over here from nonlinear shear terms. So we'll always have a pressure deficit or negative perturbation pressure when we have any sign, any non-zero vertical vorticity in the background environment, which can be caused by many different processes which we'll talk about shortly. So whether we're dealing with cyclonic or anticyclonic spin about a vertical axis, that is going to be associated with negative perturbation pressure associated with this shear term over here. So where does the shear come into play? And that's what we're going to talk about right now. So let's talk about the process here, the whole process for a thunderstorm updraft in the background environment. Let's say we have a westerly wind profile with increasing westerly winds with height above the ground. So I'll draw our x-axis over here, z-axis over here. And in general, when I draw the y-axis here, which is going to be into the page, I'll effectively angle it to the x-axis just to indicate what is into the page, something like this. So it'll be at an angle to the relative to the x-axis. And you can see that in this vertically sheared environment, using the right-hand rule over here, as Rich has talked about, that's going to be associated with horizontal vorticity that is going to be pointing into the page or orthogonal to the deep shear vector in this particular case. And so our horizontal shear or our vortex tubes are going to point into the page like this. And I'll use a dashed line to indicate that over here. Well, along comes our convective updraft, our initial convective updraft over here. And what that does is it redistributes the horizontal vortex tube. It tilts. We get tilting of the horizontal vorticity, which then becomes redistributed into the vertical. And we get two flanking vertical vorticity tubes, effectively, relative to this initial updraft. That'll look something like this. So here is our vortex tube. Here is our initial thunderstorm updraft, and that is going to be tilting our horizontal vorticity into the vertical over here. And to the relative to the deep shear, I'm going to start using terms left and right. When I use the terms left and right, we're doing it relative to this shear vector over here, which is also going to be pointing from west to east. So to the left of that deep shear vector over here, we're going to be, in this case, dealing with a downward vortex tube over here. Zeta prime is going to be less than zero, so see the anticyclonic vortmax. And then over here, we have pointing up vertical vorticity, and that'll be zeta prime greater than zero over here. And in both cases, from the nonlinear shear term over here, we're going to get negative values. P prime NL shear is going to be negative. P prime NL shear is going to be negative because we now have vertical vorticity that is non-zero on both flanks of that initial updraft. Now, initially, before we had this tilting process take place, there was no zeta prime at all, so there was no negative perturbation pressure. Now, it took that initial updraft that had to be present in order to actually get this negative perturbation pressure in order to get that vertical vorticity tilted, or I should say the horizontal vorticity be tilted into the vertical. So we had to get that initial updraft going in order to get negative perturbation pressure. And at this point now, on both flanks of the initial updraft, we have negative perturbation pressure. And what that is going to do as we have this occurring, say, aloft, maybe in the mid-levels of the atmosphere, we'll suddenly be having a deficit of pressure, and that needs to be filled. And so that is going to be inducing a perturbation pressure gradient force that's upward from relatively higher pressure down low to where that deficit has now been imposed by the redistribution of horizontal vorticity into the vertical. So now we develop new updrafts on the flanks of that initial updraft, and that is how we have storm splitting begin to take place, where we get these updraft enhancements over this vertical vorticity that flanks the initial updraft over here that was acting on this vertically sheared environment associated with horizontal vorticity. And so these negative negative perturbation pressures are effectively acting as vacuums. We've imposed these vacuums aloft that will then be drawing air upward if that air is able to reach the level of free convection. As it's being forced dynamically over here by the through a process involving this tilting of horizontal vorticity into the vertical, these negative P primes, we can get these new updrafts, and that will focus on the flanks of the initial updraft that was not rotating. We did not have this initial updraft rotate. Now we have updrafts that are occurring over the vertical vorticity that can now potentially rotate. And we'll get counter-rotating updrafts over here, since one is going to be aligned with zeta prime over here, greater than zero, and one, and that'll be to the right of that initial updraft relative to the deep shear, while the one to the left is going to be anticyclonic, a meso-anticyclone, as that is going to be aligned with that branch of the horizontal vorticity now tilted in the vertical, that is pointing down over there. So we've induced two counter-rotating updrafts on the flanks of the initial updraft. That is all this term over here, nonlinear shear term, as you can see. Now, let's talk about what's going on in a now feedback process. Now that we have upward motion associated with these new updrafts on the background vertical vorticity, there's going to be a feedback process that's induced. Remember from the vorticity equation, we talked about the check back in your notes in the exam, there's going to be a stretching term that will explain additional changes in vertical vorticity with respect to time. That term is going to be zeta partial w partial z. Now let's talk about what's going on to the right of that initial updraft over here. So to the right, where we're dealing with a mesocyclone over here, we're going to have zeta partial w partial z. We're starting out with positive zeta over there, and then with increasing height above the ground, at this ground, we have zero vertical motion. We get into the updraft, and where we have positive vertical motion, that's going to be associated with a positive value, and that's going to be associated with gains in vertical vorticity owing to stretching of the vertical vorticity over here, which results in additional vertical vorticity, which then boosts the magnitude of the right-hand side. The perturbation pressure magnitude becomes even larger, or the perturbation pressure becomes even more negative. That induces additional vertical motion. That mesocyclone increases in intensity. We have additional stretching as the updraft increases. Zeta prime becomes bigger. P prime becomes more negative. Updraft strengthens. Stretching increases. We get vertical vorticity and this feedback loop just continues. Let's do the same analysis on the left updraft that's flanking the initial updraft over here. We have zeta partial w partial z. Once again, we have this updraft over here that's associated with initial negative vertical vorticity. And when we're going up from the ground, we're going to be encountering this updraft, and that's going to be associated with positive values of partial w partial z. And therefore, for this meso-anticyclone over here associated with negative vertical vorticity, it will become more negative with time from the vorticity equation owing to stretching. And so the magnitude of that meso-anticyclone will strengthen because of stretching. Zeta prime over here, zeta prime squared, negative squared positive, that's going to become greater negative. This will become increasingly negative or more negative, and our updraft will strengthen as our perturbation pressure becomes more negative. On the left flank, our meso-anticyclone strengthens. Zeta prime increases in magnitude, P prime becomes more negative, and so both of those members of our initial storm split will both be increasing through this positive feedback process over here. And so a question that might be asked, for instance, is what physically is going on in order to get this feedback process actually come about? Let's think about it like this. We initially have this horizontal vortex tubes that are meridionally oriented, and this initial updraft is bringing that horizontal vorticity into the vertical. So imagine we now have merry-go-rounds in the mid-levels flanking that initial updraft. We've taken horizontal vorticity, spin about a horizontal axis, reoriented into the vertical. So effectively, we have two merry-go-rounds that are flanking this initial updraft. Well, if you're on a merry-go-round, you may feel some outward force pulling you away from the axis of rotation. That's called the local centrifugal acceleration, and that's the result of having an analysis of force balances in a rotating reference frame, which is non-inertial. And so that feeling of outward local centrifugal acceleration must be counterbalanced by an inward, in this case, perturbation pressure gradient force, in order to maintain circularly balanced motion. Well, how do we get that circularly balanced motion and associated counteracting perturbation pressure gradient force by removing mass from the axis of rotation vicinity, resulting in P prime going negative, so that the local centrifugal acceleration can be balanced by a perturbation pressure gradient force, since we've now caused spin to occur in the vertical by tilting the horizontal vorticity into the vertical. And so we now are dealing with two symmetric counter-rotating updrafts over here. Mesocyclone, meso-anticyclone, flanking that initial updraft to the right and to the left of that initial updraft relative to the deep shear vector.